Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Scent of Magnolia by Ashley Farley, narrated by Tiffany Morgan. Chapter 1. Scout. Scout adds her unmarked car to the cluster of Seattle's first responder vehicles parked haphazardly at the crime scene. Turning off the engine, she grips the steering wheel, bows her head, and squeezes her eyes tight. Please, God, don't let it be Sally Strickland. She stuffs her stubby ponytail into a black baseball cap and grabs her trench coat from the trunk. Blue and red flashing lights are dim in the early morning fog as she hurries up the dank alley to the back door of a pool hall where the victim is lying face down in the mud. Scout's heart skips a beat when she notices the young woman's blonde hair, the same white blonde shade as Sally. Talk to me, Scout says to her friend and coworker, homicide detective Sandra Reyes. Looks like a drug overdose. Fentanyl would be my guess. The smell of frying bacon from a nearby diner mixes with the stench of death. Locals are starting their day off with a hearty meal, while less than 50 feet away, a young woman is dead from drugs that either some jackass hoping for sex forced on her, or that she willingly took to satisfy an addiction. Some days, this job really gets to Scout. Crouching down next to the body, Scout turns the girl's right hand over to inspect the inside of her wrist. Instead of the heart tattoo Sally's mother has described in detail, she discovers an angry red scar from an apparent suicide attempt. Can I see her face, please? Scout says to a crime scene investigator. The investigator rotates the victim's head so the right side of her face is visible. The girl's young age is apparent, despite the caked mud covering her cheeks and forehead. She can't be over 14 years old, and she's definitely not Sally Strickland. Do you have any idea who she is? Sandra asks. Nope. Scout gets to her feet. I've never seen her before in my life. She walks over to a group of young people standing behind the yellow crime scene tape at the opposite end of the short alley. Morning. The kids respond in unison. Morning. She a friend of yours? Scout asks, tossing a thumb over her shoulder toward the dead girl's body. A dozen sets of eyes dart about, avoiding Scout's gaze. I've memorized the faces of every reported runaway in this country, and she's not one of them. Which means I have no way of getting in touch with her family. What if that were one of you, lying dead in a dirty alley? Wouldn't you want your family to know your fate? Wouldn't you want them to bring you home and bury you in the family plot where you belong? Wouldn't you want to end their constant worry so they could try to put the pieces of their lives back together? Her lecture is met with stony silence. Call your parents. If nothing else, let them know you're alive. From an inside coat pocket, Scout removes a stack of McDonald's gift cards and hands them out to the runaways. Get yourself some food and try to stay out of trouble. You know where to find me if you learn anything about our Jane Doe. Mumbling their gratitude for the gift cards, the group, with chins tucked and eyes glued to the ground, disperses into different directions. One runaway remains at the yellow tape, a tiny girl with pale hair and skin and electric blue eyes. The others call her Tinkerbell because she's light on her feet and walks on her toes. Scout wonders if she was a ballerina in a previous life. Tinkerbell bites down on a quivering lip. Her name is Chloe Thompson. She's from Spokane and has only been on the run for a few days, which is probably why you don't know about her. I tried to help her, but she was a real mess. Tinkerbell taps her forehead. She has some serious emotional problems. She left home on a whim, and she desperately wanted to go back, but she was afraid to contact her parents. Scout takes out her phone and types the victim's name and hometown in her notes app. Was she into drugs? I don't think so. She's been hooking up with some guy, though. I know nothing about him. Scout pockets her phone and gives Tinkerbell's shoulder a gentle squeeze. You did the right thing in telling me. She presses a business card into the girl's palm. Call me if you think of anything else. After spending a heart-wrenching afternoon with Chloe Thompson's parents, Scout enters the bailout a few minutes after 5 and orders a tequila on the rocks from the bartender. Drink in hand, she bypasses several tables of coworkers and chooses an empty booth on the far wall. She's nursing her tequila, replaying the day's events over in her mind when Barrett sits down in the booth across from her. Setting down his whiskey shot, he sheds his leather jacket, draping it over the back of the bench seat. Her heart flutters at the sight of his black t-shirt stretched tight over his muscular chest. With his scruffy beard and dark locks curling at the nape of his neck, her father would label him a thug, but beneath his rugged exterior lies a gentle giant. I heard what happened. How are you holding up? It's been a long day. I'm relieved it wasn't Sally Strickland, but I'm devastated for the Thompson family. Scout tugs her wheat-colored hair free of the elastic, letting it fall to her shoulders. Every time I lose a runaway, I travel back in time 17 years. Why can't I move on from my brother's disappearance? Barrett cocks his head as if to say, really? You know why. Because you need closure. Right. If only I knew how to get it. Scout drains the last of the tequila and sets the glass on the table with a clunk. Ford would never intentionally leave me hanging like this. I have a strong social media presence. There must be a legitimate reason he hasn't contacted me. Because he doesn't want to be found. Barrett kicks back the shot of whiskey. Your parents still live in the same house. Ford knows the way home. Scout refuses to accept the possibility her brother is avoiding her on purpose. I can think of other legitimate reasons that would prevent him from going home. Scout ticks them off on her fingers. He's incapacitated and can't travel. He's in jail. God forbid, he might be dead. When we idolize someone, Scout, we have a tendency to overlook their flaws. Scout glares at Barrett. You're always so hard on him when you've never even met him. I'm a homicide detective, trained to deal with the facts. Your brother disappeared during the early hours of the morning 3 days after Christmas 17 years ago. The police ruled out the possibility of abduction, which means he ran away. While visions of sugar plums danced in your head, he climbed out of his bedroom window with his guitar slung over his back. He may very well be unable to travel, but he still has access to a phone. He called your mother for crying out loud. Scout's pointer finger shoots up. Once, 5 years after he left, it was late at night and the line was static. Mom could barely hear what he was saying. What if Ford escaped from his kidnappers and made it to a phone to call Mom, but the kidnappers caught him and killed him? Barrett snorts. You're letting your imagination get the best of you again. Scout laughs at herself. Okay, so maybe that is far-fetched. But I can't rule out the possibility something happened to him. He could have amnesia. If he has amnesia now, he didn't have it when he left home or when he called your mom 5 years later. Running away is a coward's way of solving one's problems. Says the man from the happy family with loving parents and close-knit siblings. Scout's phone vibrates the table, and she glances down at the screen. Why are Mom and Mary Beth calling me at the same time? This can't be good. Barrett grabs their empty glasses. I'll get us some refills while you talk to them. Scout picks up the phone but hesitates as she decides whose call to accept. Finally, she clicks on Mary Beth's number. You and Mom are calling me at the same time. What's wrong? Alice committed suicide this morning. Mary Beth blurts. While she's relieved it's not bad news about Ford, Scout feels guilty she hasn't thought about her childhood friend Alice in years. That's too bad. How'd she do it? Scout, that's awful. Only you would ask such a thing. I'm a detective, Mary Beth. It goes with the territory. If you say so. Anyway, The funeral's on Friday. You need to be here. Since when did you get so bossy? Since I became the mother of a toddler. Besides, if I'm not firm with you, you'll try to weasel your way out of coming, and there's no excuse for missing Alice's funeral, Scout. One legitimate reason pops into Scout's mind. Did you call Kate? I left several messages with her assistant. I'm waiting to hear from her now. You can no longer hide behind your animosity toward Kate. We're all adults now, Scout. The time has come for you to put this petty vendetta behind you. Scout sighs. I don't expect you to understand my feelings for Kate. But you're right. I should be there for Alice's family. Can I stay with you? As much as I would love that, your mom would be heartbroken if you don't stay at home. Scout notices Barrett heading back toward the table with another tequila for her and a Miller Lite for himself. I've got to run, Mary Beth. I'll text you my flight information. Barrett slides her drink across the table. Why the long face? Scout stares at the clear liquid in her glass. An old friend committed suicide. Gosh, that's awful, Scout. I'm so sorry. Thanks. Alice lived across the street from me growing up, but we haven't been close since we were kids. Life has not been good to her. She has a drug addiction, suffered from bipolar disorder, and self-medicated a lot with illegal drugs. She's been in and out of rehab most of her adult life. That must have been tough on her family. Scout looks past him to the back room. The pool table is open. Let's grab it. She crawls out of the booth and makes a beeline for the pool room at the back of the pub. Barrett racks the balls and Scout breaks, sending the solid blue number 2 ball to the far corner right pocket. She sinks 3 more solids in 2 turns before missing. How long will you stay in Alabama? Barrett asks as he lines up his shot. Scout props herself against her cue stick. As short amount of time as possible. The funeral is Friday. I imagine I'll head back to Seattle on Saturday. Barrett makes his shot and scrutinizes the table for another opportunity. You have years worth of vacation time built up. Why not stay for a while? Why would I do that? There is literally nothing to do in Langford, Alabama. And 2 days is as long as I can stand to be in the dictator's presence. Instead of laughing at her father's nickname, he scolds her with his dark eyes. Give your parents a chance, Scout. People don't change, Barrett. Maybe people don't, but circumstances do. He takes an angle shot and misses. You're an adult now. You might find you have more in common with your parents than you think. She considers the possibility. I haven't thought about it like that, but maybe you're right. After all this time, we're virtually strangers to one another. Maybe we can start over on a level playing field. You never know. At least stay through the weekend. Besides, spending some much overdue time with your parents, you could search for clues about your missing brother. That investigation is dead. Scout says, leaning over the table as she lines up her next shot. Says who? Your 18-year-old self? You're an accomplished detective now, Scout. With your keen senses and seasoned eyes, you're bound to come up with something. The answers are there. You just need to find them. Maybe. She cleans the table and returns her cue stick to the wall rack. That's a wrap. I'm out of here. Hey, what about dinner? They have a standing deal that the loser pays for dinner. I wish I could, but I need to make travel arrangements. Barrett tugs on his jacket. I might as well go home, too. I've been procrastinating on some paperwork. They exit the bailout together, pausing in front of Barrett's motorcycle parked on the curb. Good luck in Alabama, kiddo. If you need me, I'm only a phone call away. When he kisses her cheek, she imagines what his lips might feel like on hers. But she's not his type. He prefers beautiful women with sexy bodies. He would never look twice at a girl with a lopsided smile and boyish figure. Scout experiences a sick feeling in her gut as she watches him speed away on his bike and she can't shake the feeling of impending doom during the drive home. Her life is about to change, and there's nothing she can do to stop it. She's lived in the same dingy apartment building in a seedy part of downtown since first arriving in Seattle 15 years ago. Many of her friends have upgraded to swanky buildings with open floor plans and rooftop pools. Scout doesn't see the point in paying premium rent for a place to lay her head. She no longer believes in the concept of home. Over the years, she's witnessed too much heartache born out of dysfunctional families and broken homes. Creating a happy home is a pie-in-the-sky dream only a blessed few ever achieve. Barrett's words come back to her as she books her airline ticket. She's a confident young woman now, no longer the confused teenager who left home for college and never looked back. Maybe a fresh perspective will lead her to a new discovery about Ford's disappearance. Scout folds an assortment of black tops and blue jeans into her small rolling suitcase. There was a time when she enjoyed wearing fun clothing and festive colors, but Ford drained all the life out of her world when he abandoned her. Chapter 2. Kate. Kate studies the eager faces gathered around her conference table. She's toying with her staff, making them wait for her reaction. She plants her hands on the table as though bracing herself to deliver bad news and says, "I absolutely love it." The men and women exhale a collective sigh of relief. "This is our most spectacular line of handbags we've launched to date. Our clients will be thrilled come spring. You've clearly put forth your best efforts. You can all look for fat bonuses in your next paychecks." Cheers and applause fill the conference room. She closes her laptop. "Take the rest of the day off. Grab an early dinner. Celebrate. You deserve it." "How generous of you," says Anya, her head designer. "It's already 5:30.
"Is it really?"
Kate checks her Apple Watch. "I didn't know it was so late. In that case, enjoy your evening. First thing tomorrow morning, we'll start executing the new designs." As the designers and marketers exit en masse from the conference room, her administrative assistant brushes past them on her way in. Vivian waves a stack of pink "while you were out" messages at her. "Some woman named Mary Beth has been trying to reach you. She's called 3 times in the past hour. She claims it's urgent. She says she knows you from Alabama." Vivian peers at Kate over the top of her tortoiseshell glasses. "When did you attend Alabama? I thought you graduated from NYU.
"The state, Vivian, not the university. I grew up in Alabama."
Kate takes the messages from her assistant and walks down the hall to her office. Seated at her desk, she stares down at her phone screen. She hasn't spoken to anyone from Langford since she moved with her father to New York 17 years ago. Something tragic must have happened if Mary Beth went to the trouble of tracking her down. "Please don't let it be June." Kate inhales an unsteady breath before punching in the number. Mary Beth answers on the first ring, and the old friends exchange a moment of awkward pleasantries.
"I'm afraid I have some bad news," Mary Beth says finally. "Alice committed suicide last night."
Kate relaxes back in her chair, relieved the news isn't about June.
"I'm sorry to hear that. Her family must be devastated."
"Alice hasn't been well for a long time. Naturally, they're upset, but this wasn't her first attempt, and no one was surprised. Anyway, I thought you'd want to know. We were so close as children." Memories rush back to Kate of swimming parties and summer nights playing kick the can in the neighborhood, but those happy times quickly slide away, and visions from her miserable high school days flash before her. "The funeral is Friday. I hope you can make it. It would mean a lot to Alice's family, and I'd love to see you again. We have much to catch up on." As Mary Beth rattles on, Kate opens her top drawer and removes a tattered photograph taken in the Montgomerys' backyard at one of their many talent shows. Ford's fan club, Kate, Mary Beth, Alice, and Scout surround him while his guitar dangles from his neck.
"I assume Scout will be there?"
"She's flying in from Seattle tomorrow."
Since when does Scout live in Seattle?
Kate wonders. She really is out of touch. She opens her mouth to tell Mary Beth she can't make the trip. Instead, she asks for a hotel recommendation. Try the Meeting Inn. I've heard amazing reviews about their recent renovations. I hope you'll come for a casual dinner tomorrow night. I'll text you the address. I'd like that, Mary Beth. I look forward to seeing you then. Dropping her phone on the desk, Kate spins around in her chair and stares down 7 flights at Madison Avenue. What just happened? She vowed never to return to Langford, yet she gave Mary Beth 0 pushback about attending the funeral. Kate rarely makes impulse decisions. She attributes her success as a top fashion designer to her cautious nature and her sound business acumen. Dad is going to freak when I tell him. And speaking of Philip, she glances at her watch. His reception starts in a few minutes. In the adjoining bathroom, Kate freshens her makeup and ties her mahogany hair back in a tight knot. Grabbing her tote bag, she takes the elevator down to the lobby and summons a taxi. The trip to Washington Heights takes longer than usual in rush hour traffic, and she arrives as a hospital's senior vice president is announcing her father's appointment to head of pediatrics. Kate stands on her tiptoes to glimpse her father as he takes the podium. He looks sharp in a navy suit with red and white striped tie. She snickers when he struggles to adjust the microphone to accommodate his tall frame. Bart appears beside her with 2 glasses of red wine. "Kate! You're looking as lovely as ever," he says, offering her a glass. "Thanks." She accepts the glass and turns her attention back to her father. Bart leans in close. "Can we talk afterward?" he whispers near her ear. "Shh." She presses a finger to her lips as her father begins his speech. Philip expresses his gratitude for his appointment before attributing his success to his humble beginnings as the only pediatrician in a small Alabama town. "I treated patients with everything from strep throat to leukemia. I learned many valuable lessons from my time in Langford, from those courageous patients and their loving parents. But I gained the most wisdom from being a single parent for my daughter from the time she was a year old." Her father talks on about how parents are the real heroes and the hardships families face when coping with critically sick children. He's wrapping up his comments when Bart tugs on her coat sleeve and leads her outside to a small courtyard. "I miss you, Kate. Won't you please give our relationship another chance?" Kate is tempted to say yes. She misses having a date for certain functions. And she misses having someone to spend Friday nights with when she's not in the mood to go out. But she doesn't miss Bart. "There's no point, Bart. You know how I feel." "Come on, Kate. True love is overrated. Compatibility is what matters. We belong to the same social circles, and we share the same political views. We both like to sail and snow ski and go for long walks in the park on Saturday afternoons." Those are things friends do together. But when it comes to marriage, I'm holding out for more. She kisses his cheek. "It was good to see you, but if you'll excuse me, I need to congratulate Dad." Returning to the reception, Kate makes her way around the room, speaking to her father's many colleagues. The crowd is thinning by the time she locates Philip near the door. She hugs his waist. "You did great, Dad. Congratulations. I'm really proud of you." "Thanks, sweetheart." He kisses the top of her head. She pulls away from him. "Are you almost finished here? I need to talk to you about something important."
"Sure thing."
He gestures at the door.
"My driver's waiting out front. Can I give you a ride home?"
"That would be great." They exit the hospital and climb into the black sedan waiting at the curb. Philip pats his longtime driver on the shoulder.
"Good evening, Charles. Please drop us at Duke Ellington Circle. We'll walk the rest of the way."
Charles finger salutes him.
"Yes, sir, Dr. Baldwin."
Her father settles back in his seat.
"Is this about Bart? I saw you two talking. He's a fine young man and a good friend. Is there any chance you're getting back together?"
"None." Kate offers him a sympathetic smile. I'm sorry to upset you, Dad. I know you hoped Bart would be your son-in-law. He is a fine young man and a good friend, but he's not the one for me. Philip gives her a solemn nod. I understand. I just want to see you settled and happy. When they reach their destination, they get out of the car and head south on Fifth Avenue. The leaves haven't begun to change, but the air has the crispness of fall as they walk along Central Park. Kate takes hold of her father's elbow. You surprised me when you mentioned Langford in your comments earlier. Why don't you ever talk about the past?
I thought it best, since your childhood was so unhappy.
My childhood was happy. It was my high school years I'd like to forget. Kate stares down at the sidewalk. Mary Beth called me today. Alice Johnson committed suicide.
I'm sorry to hear that, her father says with a sympathetic cluck of his tongue. I remember Alice well. She was my patient.
As was every other child in town.
Philip chuckles. True, but poor Alice struggled with anxiety from early on. She was in high school when I sent her to Atlanta for treatment. They diagnosed her with bipolar disorder.
Kate shakes her head in disbelief. I knew she had problems, but I didn't realize they were that bad. She inhales a deep breath. I told Mary Beth I'd come for the funeral. Philip stops walking and turns to face her.
Why? You haven't been friends with Alice since you were children.
I can't explain it. I feel a powerful pull, like a magnetic attraction, to Langford. Maybe it was hearing Mary Beth's voice, or maybe I'm intrigued by the prospect of seeing June again.
June isn't your mother, Kate,
he says, and they start walking again. Maybe not, but she played a major role in my upbringing. Is it wrong of me to want to see her again?
Under the circumstances, it's dangerous for you to revisit the past. After your mother left, I should have married the first woman who came along. Any mother would have been better than no mother.
That's not true, Dad. You were an amazing single parent. Kate increases her pace to keep up with her father as they cross Fifth Avenue. For your sake, I wish you had remarried. I hate that you've been alone all these years. Philip smiles over at her.
I'm not alone. I have you.
It's not the same, and you know it. She loops her arm through his, and they continue the rest of the way to her apartment building in silence. Philip pulls Kate out of the way of residents entering and exiting her building.
I'm warning you, Kate. Once you open this can, you won't be able to put the worms back in.
I have unfinished business in Langford that has hung over my head long enough.
Then I'll come with you. We'll make a mini vacation out of it and drive down to the coast. We'll book a guide and try to catch a tarpon on the fly.
I appreciate your concern, but this is something I need to do alone. His disappointed face is a stab of guilt in her heart. But a fishing trip sounds nice. Can I take a rain check?
Of course. Philip squeezes her arm. If things don't go your way in Alabama, I'll be on the next plane headed south.
She stands on her tiptoes to kiss his cheek. Don't worry, Dad. Everything will be fine.
I hope you're right, sweetheart.
Kate watches her father disappear into a throng of commuters before entering her building. In her apartment, she books her travel reservations, packs a suitcase, and makes a salad with leftover rotisserie chicken for dinner. After storing her plate in the dishwasher, she brews a cup of lavender tea and takes it out to her garden terrace. Her mind drifts as she thinks back to one of the most defining moments of her life. During her first months of kindergarten, she came home from school one day in tears. Mrs. Rice, their sour-faced housekeeper and nanny, could do little to console her. She was still upset when her dad arrived home from work that evening. After much coaxing, she showed him her masterpiece, a drawing of him and Mrs. Rice. She explained, "The teacher told us to draw a picture of our families. She asked if Mrs. Rice was my mama. I told her I don't have a mama. Why don't I have one, Daddy? All the other kids do.
Her father lifted Kate onto his lap. You have a mama, sweetheart. She just chooses not to live with us.
Kate's golden brown eyes widened. Where does she live?
I don't know, honey. I wish I did.
She pouted her lower lip. Make her come home. He chuckled, fingering her lip.
How can I do that when I don't know where she is?
What's my mama's name?
Her name is Honey.
Kate repeated the name, relishing the way it felt on her lips. I like that name. Why don't we have any pictures of her?
I have one. Her father leaned forward as he freed his wallet from his back pocket. He handed her the worn photograph of the prettiest woman Kate had ever seen, with flowing golden hair and a spattering of freckles across her nose.
She's really pretty.
Yes, she is, sweetheart.
I'm sad, Daddy. Kate buried her face in his chest. Can Miss June be my mama?
She asked, her words muffled by his shirt. You know Miss June is Ford and Scout's mother, but she loves you as though you were her own daughter.
I don't like Mrs. Rice. She's mean.
She's not mean, Kate, but I agree. She is a better housekeeper than Nanny.
Kate looked up at her father with fresh tears in her eyes. Can you get me a new mama? He tightened his arms around her.
I can't do that, sweetheart. But I can see what I can do about getting you a nicer nanny.
Chapter 3. June. June puts the finishing touches on the porch table, pink gingham linen napkins, magnolia-scented candles, and a bouquet of assorted roses from her garden. Her husband's favorite dinner is almost ready. Crab casserole in the oven, homemade cornbread in the warming drawer, and arugula salad in the fridge awaiting lemon vinaigrette dressing. She nurses a glass of crisp rosé while she awaits her husband's arrival home from work. At 6:30 sharp, Buford walks through the door and she hands him a whiskey sour.
What's the occasion?
He asks when he notices the decorative table.
I have exciting news, June says, even though she's sure he'll find her news anything but exciting.
Really? So do I.
He opens the glass-paned door leading to the porch.
Why don't we take our cocktails outside? It's a shame to waste this pleasant weather.
As they cross the back porch, June fills her lungs with the cool air. Smells like autumn.
Mm-hmm. Won't be long until the leaves change.
They stroll past her rose garden.
You need to do something about these roses, June. They're taking over the backyard.
June lets out a breath of indignation. I'll have you know, Southern Living recently contacted me about doing an article on this overgrown rose garden.
Buford appears surprised. That's wonderful, June. Congratulations. I know how hard you work in the yard. What do I know about roses anyway?
Warmth fills her chest at the rare compliment. They move past the rose garden to the glaring space in the back corner of the yard where her beloved magnolia tree once stood. Even after 2 years, I still miss that magnolia. What do you think about putting a hammock in this space?
A hammock? Don't you need trees from which to hang it? Asks Buford.
I was thinking we could get one of those metal stands.
Those contraptions are eyesores. I thought the idea was to hang a hammock in the shade, and in order to have shade, you need trees. So why not plant 2 maple saplings? In a few years, you'll have big enough trees from which to hang your hammock.
June considers his suggestion. There's not enough room for 2 maples. Maybe I'll just replace the magnolia. It's not summer in the South without the magnolia bloom's citrusy scent. They continue around the side of the house to the live oak in the front yard.
June lowers herself to a sprawling branch and tilts her chin up, letting the late-day sun's dappled rays warm her face.
"Tell me your news," Buford says.
"You go first," she says with eyes closed. Buford clears his throat.
"I'm thinking of running for governor."
Her pale blue eyes open wide. "But you've been out of politics for more than 10 years.
"Correction, I haven't held an office in 10 years, but I've been doing important work for the party behind the scenes."
He smooths back the graying hair at his right temple.
"I'm disappointed, June. I thought you'd be more supportive."
"You know you can count on me for support." She stands up and turns to face him. "I'm just surprised. I thought you were finished with politics."
"I've been holding out for the right opportunity."
June imagines her husband through voters' eyes. He's handsome and physically fit, and his strong personality commands attention. The intense scowl he wore in younger days has developed into permanent grooves in his forehead. She imagines his handlers will insist he have Botox to soften those lines. "Governor? Wow, that's a big deal."
"And you'll make a wonderful first lady. Coincidentally, we're hosting a dinner party here on Sunday night. Bring in your caterer and hire a bartender. I can't have you running around in your apron when you should entertain our guests."
"I'm insulted, Buford. When have I ever worn my apron while entertaining guests?" Turning her back on him, she starts toward the driveway. Buford hurries to catch up with her.
"Don't be so sensitive, June. You know what I meant. This event is important. I can't afford any screw-ups."
June shakes off her irritation as she continues around the side of the house to the mudroom. "I assume we're talking about a seated dinner. For how many people?"
10 or 12 at the most. This is a meeting. We'll eat at the table in the dining room where we can have an open discussion."
June pauses before opening the back door. "And who's on the guest list?" Buford names several people she knows. The last one steals her breath. Raquel Ramsey is back in their lives, or perhaps she never left.
"I see."
June pours the rest of her rosé into a boxwood bush and goes inside. Buford follows her into the kitchen.
"Tell me your news."
"I have both bad and good news. I assume you heard about Alice Johnson."
"Of course. Everyone was talking about her at the firm today. She was a creepy little girl. Obviously, she never got her act together."
"Don't be cruel, Buford. She was a troubled child who grew into a troubled adult."
June makes a big show of putting on her apron and tying it around her waist.
"The good news is, Scout is coming home for the funeral."
Buford grunts.
"I hardly consider that good news."
"Buford, that's awful. You haven't seen your daughter in years. Show some excitement."
He dumps his ice in the sink.
"That's like asking me to show excitement about a tornado threat."
June plants her hands on her hips.
"How can you say that about your own daughter?"
"Because she's a black cloud of anger and frustration,"
he says, pouring a splash of bourbon into his glass.
"Wonder where she gets that from,"
June mumbles under her breath. Anger flashes in his hazel eyes.
"What did you say?"
June stares him down.
"You heard me."
She takes the crab casserole out of the oven and places it onto a trivet on the counter. "Scout is no longer the volatile teenager we remember. She's highly successful at her job."
"Some job. Chasing vagabonds."
"Runaways," she says, correcting him.
"Same difference."
He downs his bourbon.
"At least I can count on her visit being brief. With luck, she'll be gone before the dinner on Sunday."
"You're incorrigible,"
she says, removing the salad from the refrigerator and drizzling on the dressing.
"Why? Because I don't want my apple cart upset? I'm content with our lives. We've lived in peace these past...
He waves a hand around as though swatting at a fly.
However many years it's been since she left.
16 years, 6 weeks and 4 days. And peace is overrated, Buford.
After the hell those kids put us through, I'll take the way things are now over the way things were then any day.
No one ever said parenting would be easy. She serves their plates and pushes past him on the way to the porch. She lights the candle and sits down at her place. When he joins her, they say the blessing together and eat in silence, as they so often do. While she'll never admit it to her husband, June agrees their apple cart is way more peaceful now than during the children's teenage years. Things couldn't be better. She has a beautiful home and leads an active social life. She's grateful her foster daughter is in her life, but Mary Beth can't replace her children. Scout lives across the country, though, and only the Lord and Ford know where he is. The estrangement eats at her every single day. In all the years Scout's been gone, Buford has never once reached out to his daughter. He knows that June talks to Scout every few months on the phone, but he never asks about her well-being. He was desperate for children when they first married. Was it because he wanted to be a father, or because he needed props for his first election campaign for senator? Chapter 4. June. March 1986. Buford had never mentioned the cocktail party he and June were attending in Mobile was actually a $1,000-a-head political rally. When he abandoned her within 5 minutes of arriving, she found herself surrounded by a group of young women who fawned over her as though she were a celebrity. They complimented her attire and appearance. One pretty redhead even told her she was the luckiest girl in Alabama. "I'd give anything to be in your shoes." June pasted on a smile and said thank you, even though she had no clue why they were being so nice. Southerners were known to be welcoming, but their praise was excessive. She felt like she was back in college at Chapel Hill, being rushed for a sorority. Their odd behavior made sense when the governor took the podium after dinner and announced Buford's candidacy for Senate. She graciously accepted congratulations from the women and men seated at their table, but inside, she was seething. How could her husband make such an important decision without consulting her first? Toward the end of the evening, a sophisticated woman with silky black hair and almond-shaped brown eyes approached June in the bathroom.
"You're June Montgomery. I've heard so much about you."
June, having never seen the woman before, was taken aback. "Oh, from whom?" The woman coughed up a condescending laugh.
"Aren't you just darling? From Buford, of course."
She thrust a hand at June.
"I'm Raquel Ramsey, his campaign manager."
June glanced down at her hand without shaking it. "Funny, he's never mentioned you to me," she said, digging in her clutch for her lipstick. Raquel retracted her hand.
"You and I will be working a lot together in the coming months. Buford asked me to help improve your image. Aside from being a homemaker, do you have anything of interest on your resume?"
June swiped the lipstick across her lips and dropped the tube back into her clutch. "I don't have a resume. I belong to the Junior League, and I volunteer every week on the children's ward at the hospital. I love to garden, and our home will be featured in the October edition of Southern Living."
"How wonderful. Just in time for the election."
Raquel admired her reflection in the mirror.
"Buford warned me you're the quintessential Southern Belle."
June glared at Raquel's reflection in the mirror. "Why would he warn you about something like that? Since when is it bad to be Southern?" Raquel powdered her nose and snapped her compact shut.
"The older generation of Alabama women will think you're a sweetheart, but most of them are already loyal to the party. It's the younger ones, the feminist, we want to target with this campaign. We were hoping for a more progressive first lady, but we'll figure out a way to improve your image."
My image doesn't need improving. Now, if you'll excuse me, my husband is waiting for me, June said and exited the restroom. June looked everywhere for her husband, finally catching up with him in the valet line. She waited until they were in the car heading back to Langford before blurting, "You could have told me."
"The powers that be asked me to keep the lid on it until tonight."
"I can't believe they wouldn't let you tell your wife. This affects my life too, you know."
"I wanted to surprise you, June. I thought you'd be happy for me."
"You surprised me, all right," she mumbled. A self-satisfied smirk appeared on his lips.
"Isn't it fabulous? Imagine me, James Buford Montgomery in the United States Senate."
"Since when do you have political aspirations?" Buford puffed out his chest.
"I have a calling. My country needs me."
"Making a healthy donation to the armed forces would be a lot easier than becoming a senator," she said, looking away from him and staring out the window.
"The Senate is merely a stepping stone to the White House. I will one day run for President of the United States."
He stroked her thigh through the black crepe fabric of her cocktail dress.
"I can't do this without your support, honey. I need my beautiful wife and children by my side."
The mention of children brought silence to the car. Her inability to conceive was a sore subject. Truth be told, June was more upset that he had kept her in the dark about the campaign than she was about him running for the Senate. She relished the idea of traveling around the state with her husband, of being on his arm at political rallies and for television appearances. She'd buy a whole new wardrobe. She would charm the press, and they would love her. She'd be the modern-day Jackie Kennedy. Much to her dismay, Buford never invited her to accompany him on the campaign trail. Raquel Ramsey was the woman by his side in all the television appearances. Buford was gone most weeks during the months that followed, and when he was home on the weekends, his primary focus was getting June pregnant. In late May, after yet another negative pregnancy test, she asked, "Why the rush, Buford? We're only 26 years old. We've got plenty of time to start our family."
"I'm ready to be a father now,"
he snapped, but June suspected he was more interested in having a pregnant wife to flaunt at campaign events. June soon grew lonely, and with so many empty hours to fill, she decided to plant a rose garden. One Sunday, in late June, she was planting two new varieties of David Austin roses when she noticed a moving truck hauling a yellow Volkswagen Bug with California license plates pull into the driveway at the house next door. A young woman with yellow blonde hair got out of the passenger side, slammed the door, and vanished inside the house. The long limbs of the man June assumed was her husband appeared from behind the wheel. He paused for a moment, staring up at his new house with a satisfied smile before following his wife inside. June kept a close eye on the Cape Cod next door during the days that followed. She spotted the man often, drinking coffee on his back porch in the mornings, dragging stacks of folded boxes to the curb for garbage pickup, and inspecting the trees and shrubs in his yard. But June didn't see his wife again until she ventured over with a welcome casserole on Friday afternoon. As she was approaching the porch, the back door swung open and the young woman floated across the porch, her long sundress billowing around her sandaled feet. Noticing June, she asked, "Who are you?" June was awestruck by her ethereal beauty, her sun-kissed skin and angelic face. "I'm June Montgomery, your next-door neighbor." She held up the dish in her oven-mitted hands. "I brought you a casserole to welcome you to the neighborhood." The woman, her lip curled in distaste, looked down at the casserole and back up at June. "They warned me about this." June shook her head in confusion. "I'm sorry. Who warned you about what?" "My friends in California told me to be aware of Southern hospitality, that you people will use it to get into my personal business." She flapped her hand at the back door.
Just put it in the kitchen. I've got to run. I'm meeting friends.
As she watched the woman speed off in the yellow bug, June wondered who she was meeting and if they had friends in common. June continued to the kitchen, where dishes and cookware covered every inch of counter space. For lack of a better place to put it, she slid the casserole into the oven. As she was turning to leave, she glimpsed a blank canvas on an artist easel in the adjacent room. She glanced around to make certain no one was watching before venturing inside the room. Natural light streamed in from a large picture window onto beautiful landscapes of rocky beaches decorating the back wall.
"Hello there,"
said a deep voice behind her. June's face warmed as she turned to face the new homeowner, his large frame taking up much of the doorway.
"I'm sorry. I'm being nosy. Are you an artist?"
Her hand shot up.
"Sorry. Nosy again. None of my business."
He chuckled.
"I don't mind. I'm actually a pediatrician. My wife's the artist."
Once again, June's eyes traveled to the paintings. "She's quite talented."
"She claims I squashed her creativity by making her leave California, hence the blank canvas."
He inclined his head at the easel.
"She made her choice. She was aware of my dream of becoming a small-town pediatrician when she married me."
June considered this information too personal to share with a stranger. With an outstretched hand, she closed the distance between them.
"I'm June Montgomery from next door. I brought you a casserole. Chicken tetrazzini. I put it in the oven. It's still warm, but you can freeze it if you already have dinner plans."
"That's very kind of you. Thanks. And I'm Philip Baldwin."
June tugged her hand free of his soft grip.
"I should go. If you need anything, you know where to find me."
Philip followed her outside to the porch.
"Actually, there is one thing you might help me with. I've noticed you working in your yard. Mine, as you can see, is a jungle,"
he said, sweeping an arm at his backyard. June studied the overgrown shrubs.
"You definitely have your work cut out for you. The previous neighbor was an elderly woman, and she let things get run down. Does your wife enjoy yard work?"
"Honey isn't the domesticated type. She's a bit of a free spirit. A bit of a handful, too."
June coughed up a nervous laugh. "Being a homemaker isn't for everyone."
"You seem to find it enjoyable,"
he said with a warm smile.
"I do. I've never been particularly ambitious. Some would consider that a character flaw."
June shrugged. "I'm just following in my mama's footsteps."
"Nothing wrong with that."
He returned his attention to the yard.
"Anyway, I plan to organize the kitchen in the morning and spend the rest of the weekend cleaning up this mess. Maybe you can tell me what's worth keeping and what I should clear out."
"Sure. If you'd like, I can spare a few minutes now before my husband gets home."
"That'd be great. What does your husband do?"
Philip asked as they moved toward the yard.
"He's an attorney, but he's also running for U.S. Senate. He's on the campaign trail more than he's at home right now."
Philip appeared impressed.
"A senator? That's impressive. I admit I'm not much of a politician."
"Neither was he until a few months ago."
Philip gave her a curious look, but refrained from commenting.
"What is this leggy plant?"
he asked, pointing to a row of top-heavy shrubs bordering the back porch.
"Nandina." June picked off one of the plant's small leaves. "I'm not a fan of Nandina, although the berries are nice to use for decorating at Christmas. These are way overgrown. They're blocking the view from your porch. You can find something more suitable for this space."
"Such as?"
"I can think of several smaller shrubs. You should visit a nursery. Sun and Shade Garden Center on Old Mobile Highway is my favorite."
June lost track of time as they wandered around the yard. Philip already knew a fair amount about plants and trees. Most of the ones he couldn't identify were indigenous to the South. When she glanced at her watch, she was surprised to see an hour had passed since she left home.
"I should go. Buford will be home any minute, and I need to get dinner ready."
"Don't let me keep you. Thank you again for the casserole and the gardening advice."
June felt his eyes on her as she hurried down the driveway to the back door. The phone was ringing when she entered the house.
June, where have you been? I've been trying to reach you for an hour.
I took a casserole to our new neighbors. What's up? I thought you'd be home by now.
About that, Raquel booked a last-minute segment on the 6 o'clock news at the local ABC affiliate in Huntsville. Since we're already in the northern part of the state, we've decided to campaign through the weekend.
June gripped the phone's receiver. You mean you're not coming home?
Not until Sunday, but I can stay for a few days next week. I need to catch up on some work at the office. I realize the situation is difficult for you, June. Being away from you is hard on me, too. But the election is only a few months away.
Why?
Listen, honey, I've got to run. They're calling for me. Talk to you soon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.